You never lie. Falling in. Hallelujah. Anybody got a made up mind tonight? Amen. Going to make it all the way? Amen. And you know, I'm glad tonight that I know how to get there. You know, salvation, Pastor, is a whole lot easier than cooking. I know what it takes to make it to heaven. Amen. Brother Morgan, it's repentance. You can be seated. It's baptism in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. Being filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in other tongues. And living an overcoming life that's pleasing unto the Lord. It's easier for salvation than it is for cooking. My wife worked a late clinic last night. Didn't get in till 7, so she gave me a task. She said, when you get home, she said, there's some chicken pot pies in the freezer. She said, get them out. Take them out of the box, put them on a cookie sheet. Set it for 30 minutes at whatever the temperature says. She said, and I'll be home in about 20 minutes. I said, okay. So, Brother Morgan, I got the pot pies out. I looked on it, and it said cook for 50 minutes at 400 degrees. So I thought, I'll set it for 40 minutes. So we've got this new stove, and so I reach over and I push bake. I type in 400 degrees. I lay them out nice and neat on a cookie sheet, put them in, Brother Morgan. I set the timer for 40 minutes. My wife gets home and she goes into the office area there to pay some bills, and the timer goes off, and I said, I set it for 40 minutes. And she said, well, with chicken, said it's got to be 50 minutes. I said, well, I'll go set it for 10 more minutes. So I kicked the timer in for 10 more minutes, and the timer went off, and my wife went to serve supper. She opened the oven, and I heard a laugh. Brother Morgan, these started out to be frozen dinners, and they ended up being frozen dinners. She said, you got to hit the start button. So, folks, salvation's easier than cooking for me. Amen. Amen. Ushers, come right ahead. We're going to give tonight unto the Lord's kingdom. And Brother Daniels, he said Sunday morning, he said that he was in a service where Brother Dylan had said he felt like all, or I think he did have all the men. He said, we're going to baptize all the men's wallets. And I was thinking, Pastor, this past Sunday when he said that, I thought, man, maybe he's going to have all the men to baptize their wallets today. And I was excited because I left mine at home. I came to church without my wallet, without anything except for my keys. And I thought, go ahead and baptize them. Amen. But we're going to give to the Lord today. God's so good. How many of the Lord's been blessed? Amen. He's just been a blessing to you. I tell you what, God's been so good. And I'll make a couple of announcements before we give. Don't forget, General Conference is underway right now in Orlando, Florida, and that is our prayer focus this week, is for our General Conference. Amen. That the Lord is going to touch that conference, and that the Lord is going to speak, amen, to the United Pentecostal Church International. Amen. And then on October the 9th, this coming Sunday, is our 401 Kingdom Sunday. Amen. As we're giving unto the Lord and knocking down our debt on our Family Life Center next door. And I tell you what, it's great to just watch it as it's going down, going down, going down. And before too long, we're planning next year to have it paid off in Jesus' name. Amen. And that's going to be such a blessing. October the 15th, Single Adult Ministries Bonfire. Man, see Sister McKenna Landers on that one there, and she'll be able to tell you all about that. That's for all the unmarried ages 19 and up. And then October the 23rd, guest ministry Nate and Ingram Turner, missionaries to Estonia, Europe. We want to remember them as we get ready to have them as speaking for us on October the 23rd. And then December the 1st through the 3rd, And 8th through the 10th will be our Christmas in the Stable. Amen. Had a great time last year, Sister Holly. Done such a great job with that. They're looking for donations on the food, and you can get with her for what you need to bring on that. Amen. And it's going to be another great blessing, and as she said, another great ministry. Amen. Let's lift our hands to the Lord, and let's thank Him as we give to Him tonight. Amen. And for His kingdom. Lord, we love You today. We're so thankful for Your blessings. Thankful, Lord, that we can give to You tonight, Lord. I pray Your blessing upon every heart, Lord, as we give to Your kingdom. Multiply it, Lord, for its purpose, as we give to You with hearts of thanksgiving. In Jesus' name, God bless you as you give.
Praise the Lord, church. All we can ask is that you worship with us. We've run through this a few times, and I'm fairly confident it'll be different this time as well.
Oh, Somebody say it's going to be a happy day. And that's for all of the generation under 40 that doesn't know about a happy day. Thank God that there's going to be a glad reunion in the presence of the Lord. It's time to greet one another. There's guests here tonight, somebody that you want to say hi to. Take just a minute and cross the aisle. Welcome someone to the house of the Lord. Encourage somebody in the Lord. Tell them how thankful you are to see them in the presence of God. There's nothing like being together in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. Take just a minute and say hi to somebody. Praise God. In just a little while, Brother Morgan's going to come and pray over some needs. You may be seated after you've greeted somebody. But I know in this room tonight there are some who are struggling with cares of life, things that have been working on them throughout the week. But I just believe God is able tonight to touch us, to help us, to lift us into His presence. Let's lift our hands and magnify the Lord again and just worship Him. Hallelujah. Oh, it'd be good to close our eyes and just lift up the name of Jesus. We've got our eyes on heaven. Our gaze is lifted high. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I give you glory. Go ahead and receive a blessing right now. Let the blessing of the Lord just touch your heart, minister to your soul. Our God is so great and mighty, so powerful. Student ministry can be dismissed. They're going to go next door and have some time together this month on Wednesday evening after our worship time. Take a Bible, if you would, and join me in the book of Romans, chapter 5. If you have internet service at your house and you'd like to join the live stream for General Conference, we'll try to get that link out in our email. I think I sent it out once, but we'll try to get that link out to you by tomorrow morning. And so you can end up getting on the services. It was a tremendous, tremendous global mission service last night. Brother Joel Urshan preached a message that every one of us need to hear. And it's on, I know it's on Facebook as well, so I'll try to get those links out to you. So thankful for the United Pentecostal Church. Aren't you thankful for the fellowship that we're in? We can accomplish some things together as a local church, but many things together as a global church. I'm just grateful to be a part of the United Pentecostal Church and feel what God is doing all across the world. Come to the book of Romans chapter 5 with me, and verse 11 will be the verse that we'll spring from and talk to you a little bit this evening. And not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received the atonement. From this, I'd like to talk to this great church for a few minutes this evening on the subject of our great atonement. Our great atonement. It would be good to pray one more time for the ministry of the word. Let's lift our voices together. Lord, thank you for the opportunity to minister your word, to open this wonderful and precious book. We're expecting you to make it become a living word in our hearts. Empower, encourage, and strengthen tonight. We're going to give you praise and glory. And everybody said, in Jesus' name, amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you for being here tonight, presence of God, studying with us. And today is actually, in the Hebrew calendar, the Day of Atonement. And we're about 6 hours behind Jerusalem. I think it's 6 hours, it could be 8 hours behind Jerusalem. So at sunset, Jerusalem today, the Jewish people begin to celebrate although sacrifices were not made, an Ark of the Covenant was not sprinkled, they began to celebrate, commemorate something called the Day of Atonement. And I want to take you through that tonight. I want to begin with the concept of day. Now, this is going to not challenging information, but new information for some. The word day, let's look at Genesis chapter 1 and verse 5. If you have a Bible, you can join me. Of course, they'll project it for us. Genesis chapter 1 and verse 5 it captures this word in a very special way because it discerns between daytime and light time. God called the light, and notice in the verse, it's a capital D, isn't it? Day. And then the darkness, he didn't call it just night, but those who gave us the English version of the Bible captured the emphasis being placed upon the capital N, night. He called the light day, and the darkness he called night. So the evening and the morning were the first day. Now the sun and the moon was not made until the fourth day, which is in about verse 14. So we're not talking about a day being a celestial day, a lunar night or a celestial day. But this first day light was a special kind of light. It was the light that lighteth every man that entereth into the world. Jesus said, I am that light that lighteth every man. And it is in that context that the word day is introduced to us. It's the Hebrew word yom. Today, if you follow it, it's called Yom Kippur. That word day of at-one-ment is really how they consider it. Today, if they were offering sacrifices for their sins, Judaism would believe that God was reuniting with them, that sin had separated them from him, and that today's sacrifices of animals and blood sprinkling, that it would, under their system, reunite them with him or reconcile. And this was all playing into this. The word day in Genesis 1 and 5 and throughout the book of Genesis, it means this if you're taking notes: the space and experience of revelation. The word day is an awakening. It's more than just the clock ticking, chronos time. It's more than seasonal time. It is the experience and the space of revelation. In the first day, God revealed something, so it was called a day. In the second space or experience, God revealed something, and so it was called a day. He called it the evening and the morning of the first day, second day. Got it? So when we talk about the Day of Atonement, it was in the institution. Let's go to Leviticus 23 and get that if you would, Leviticus 23, and then go ahead and flip back left a little bit to chapter 16. We're going to spend a little time in 16 tonight. And Leviticus 23 and 27, also in the 10th day of this seventh month, there shall be a day of atonement. And this is the seventh month. October is the seventh month in the Hebrew calendar. And it shall be a day of atonement. It shall be an holy convocation unto you, holy gathering, and ye shall afflict your souls and offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord. That's foreign to us. We're people of faith. We believe that Jesus Christ offered once and for all the sacrifice for sin on the cross. If there's anybody in this room that you think there's another plan, let's get in the Word of God together, and you're going to see really fast that Jesus Christ is the only way, the only truth, the only life. Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. Oh, praise God. See, that's a day right there. That's something happened in just that moment when the light came on. And it was called Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. Leviticus 23 and 27, the Day of Atonement. The heart of atonement is one or oneness. Now, I've got big, big dreams about this service. Every service, I just approach it with great expectation that it could be the very service that God uses as a tipping point in somebody's life. You never know. Somebody could be here tonight so hungry for God and feel distant to God. Let me tell you, you don't have to find an altar and offer a sacrifice. All you've got to do is say, Lord, forgive me of my past. Forgive me of my sins, my transgressions, my iniquities, whatever. And Lord, I'm just going to need you tonight. And I'm going to have faith that the blood of Jesus, though removed many centuries, is now just as real, just as vibrant and effectual as it ever was when he offered it. Jesus Christ is our way out of sin. Hallelujah. Oh, somebody that's already been through the water, you've been through the blood, you ought to have a fresh love in your heart tonight on our Day of Atonement. Oh, God. You see, you can have a Day of Atonement on Thursday afternoon, Friday morning. In the wee hours, you can have a Day of Atonement. You don't have to wait till the seventh month and the tenth day of the month to have a Day of Atonement, because Jesus has already offered the perfect sacrifice. On the Jewish calendar, today is the Day of Atonement. Judaism had a temple, and just another report came out today that they're really wanting to build their third temple. If they had a temple and were able to certify a priesthood, they would be celebrating today an old, tired, inferior system based on the blood of animals and based on the unbelief that the Messiah has yet to come. But we are confident that Messiah has come. We are sure that Jesus Christ is the Christ, the Son of the living God. He's not only the suffering Messiah that Isaiah talked about, but he's the Davidic Messiah that's going to sit on a throne forever and make King of kings and Lord of lords. I feel the presence of our Jesus in this house. Not another Jesus, but this same Jesus that was taken up is going to come back. Praise God. I'm not worshiping at an old, tired, inferior system, but I'm worshiping Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the whole world. Oh, hallelujah. If you're here tonight and you need a Savior, I'm telling you, you're right at the right place at the right time. And all of you that have already been through the water, you've been through the Spirit, you ought to rejoice on this Day of Atonement that you've got blood flowing all over your life. Your conscience has been sprinkled. Your life, your past is gone. And Jesus made us brand new. If any man be in Christ. I was talking with someone some time ago now, and we were talking about water baptism in Jesus' name, and they were, the word is complicit. They said, oh yeah, I see that. But there was a lack of conviction in their voice. We're not just complicit or complying with what the Word of God says. We have a conviction about this water baptism in Jesus' name. We have a conviction about where the blood is applied. Hallelujah. You see, you got to go down in the water, and there's a measure of the blood of Jesus that's released in the water. And your sins, you go down sin-laden. But when you come up, your sins are covered. Because the blood has been applied. You see why that's a conviction to us? When I say conviction, I'm talking about not loving my life, but rather standing on this wonderful truth. Anybody else got a conviction? Jesus' name, baptism. Woo! Oh, look around you at people waving their hands. This is more than just complying. This is something that's down deep in our soul. I know where the blood is applied. The blood of Jesus is where the name of Jesus comes. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. You want a day of atonement? You can have it right now. He can make you one. He will reconcile you to himself. That's the power. That's the power of the blood of Jesus. It is about the name. It is about the water. But it's more than that. It's about the blood. Praise God. You got to have the blood applied. Oh, I feel the glory of the Lord here right now. Somebody's rejoicing because you already got the blood applied. Somebody here tonight needs to know that you've got the blood applied. And when you go down in that water here in a few minutes, and you go down, that blood will be applied. Now, there's a measure of blood to get us out of Egypt. That's called repentance. Everybody say repentance. In typology, when the children of Israel came out of Egypt, they came out on the night of Passover. And the presence of God swept across the land and judged all those that did not have blood on their vessel, on their abode, their house. And the doorpost and what is it, lintel or what's that top board? On the door, they were to slaughter a lamb and take hyssop and mark both sides of the door. And they weren't supposed to put it under their feet because you don't walk on the blood. The blood covers us. And when the presence of God, some people say the death angel, that's not in there. When the presence of God passed over the land, everybody that had blood on the dwelling, they got to go out of Egypt. But when there wasn't blood, the firstborn in that house died. And see, before the plagues began, Pharaoh was taking the male child, the male children. God said, I'm going to have them back. It's going to cost you, Pharaoh, and that's the last thing he did before they left, was he took back everything that Pharaoh had taken from the people of God in their progenitory. That night they went out with a measure of blood on that dwelling that they left behind. Then they passed through the sea, the Red Sea, a kind of baptism, because Paul said in Corinthians, they all passed through the water, the sea, and they were baptized unto Moses. I'm sidetracking, but I feel something happening right now about baptism, right now. And here they came through the water, and it's called the Red Sea, really the Reed Sea. And they came through the water, and they got out on the other side, and the water closed in upon the Egyptian military and destroyed them in just moments. They all drowned. And a kind of picture, a kind of portrait of what the blood of Jesus does for us in the Red Sea. When we go down in the water, everything that Egypt has put on us, when we come through that water, it's got to stay. It can't live. It's going to die in the water. And you come up a new creature in Christ Jesus. I'm looking around this room and I see some people that's been through the water. Aren't you thankful? Are you thankful tonight? I'm thankful that I'm not what I used to be. I may not be what I need to be, but I'm not what I used to be. All that sin is in that water. Somebody rejoice with me right now, because you came through the water. Woo! Let's clap our hands and magnify the Lord. Let's really give God praise right now. Oh, I feel something happening. Somebody may just want to stand up right now and say, hey, I'm getting a conviction. I've got to be baptized right now. I'll listen to your sermon, your little message from the water, but I got to be baptized right now. See, that can happen right now. If you've never been baptized in Jesus' name, right now would be a wonderful time. Just say, all right, preacher, I'm not going to be just complicit. And I've got to get some water because of the blood. I got to get the blood. I've got to get to the blood. See, the blood, it's there is no, for where the shedding of blood is, no remission. Hebrews 9:22, I heard somebody say, without the shedding of blood, without. I think that's what it says. Maybe projection can help me. Without the shedding of blood. There's no remission. And in Acts chapter 2, my God in heaven, I may not even get to atonement. And in Acts chapter 2, verse 38, this word pops up again. He said, Peter said on that day, repent and be baptized, every one of you. For what? For remission. So the blood is in there, in that water. When you go down in that water, there is an application of the blood. It's a mediation. It's a reconciliation. Somebody in this house needs to know you don't have to be distant. You may have a walk with God. You may have prayed. You may live right. You may have a dimension of morality. But there is nothing about that that is salvific or salvation. You've got to be born of water and born of spirit. You've got to know that you're in Him and He's in you. I feel something building in my soul right now. There is an application of the blood, and remission happens in the water. I said remission happens in that water. I'm going to walk on this a minute. Ooh. I've been to the water and I've been baptized. My soul cried happy and I'm satisfied. I wouldn't take nothing for my. And when I was a kid, we'd say Jersey cow. Y'all did too, didn't you? Wouldn't take nothing for my journey now. Just like the Bible. Just, man, I'm getting drunk in the Holy Ghost, right? I hadn't been on one of these in a little while. See, I know, because it says the Bible says it. Know you not that so many of us that have been buried with Christ have put on Christ. How are you buried? We're buried in the blood. I know it's water, but it's blood. You got to have blood. All right, there was blood to get them out, blood to get them on. But then they got over there and Moses received the law. Oh, praise God. You can trust the word of God. And they got out there and Pentecost came in Exodus 20. Pentecost came in Exodus 20. God gave them the covenant in tables. And they broke the law before he got down there to give it to them. Did you know that? Talk to me. Did you know that they broke the law? And they broke it in that they erected an idol. And they started worshiping around that idol. Moses came down. He was the second one to break the law. He broke the tablets and had to go back up. So everybody say sins of ignorance. Sins of ignorance. Ever studied that? Maybe we need to do that. Sister Burns, if you'll make a note, I need to cover that at some point. Sins of ignorance. The law had been given, but they didn't know the law. It had not been articulated. And God said, when you get down there with this second copy, Moses, I want you to slay a bull, and I want you to dip your fingers into the blood, and you sprinkle the people seven times. Man, I've got my umbrella out if you're going to sprinkle me with blood. That's gross. And he said, what's going to happen is I'm going to sprinkle the people with blood from the bull of atonement. They've got to be reconciled back. They didn't know the law. It's sins of ignorance. Sins of omission. Sins of commission is I'm partnering with sin in order to break the commandment. But sin of omission is I either didn't know to do it or didn't understand what God wanted. And there's blood to get you out. There's blood to keep you moving. And there's blood to keep you in the covenant. And Jesus Christ, 1 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 7, maybe I'm off tonight. There it is. Therefore, purge out, let's read it together, the old leaven. Let's go. That you may be a new lump, since you truly are unleavened. For indeed, Christ, our Passover. When Jesus died on Passover, AD 30, it was blood that reached all the way back to Adam and got us out of bondage. But my text tonight, Romans 5 and 11, says it's more than that. It's also the blood of atonement that keeps us in fellowship and reconciliation with Him. See, you got to have the blood. You got to have the blood from repentance through water baptism into the Holy Ghost indwelling and into this walk with God. You got to have the blood of Jesus every day you live. Every day I live, I've got to have the blood. Praise God. Would you want to worship the Lord with me right now? Something's turning. Thank Him for the blood. You thank Him for what you want to thank Him for, but I encourage you to thank Him for the blood right now. Something's turning in somebody's spirit tonight. He came, Jesus of Nazareth, born of a virgin. The one whose name is called Emmanuel. Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Got a few more minutes? Let's go to Leviticus 16 for a minute. Let's walk through a couple of things. It feels like I've missed it just a little bit. I may have just needed to talk about water baptism tonight. There's nothing like being baptized in Jesus' name. If you think back to that moment when you went down in faith, came up with the sins gone, remitted. Oh, I was there when my burdens were rolled away. Hallelujah. Praise God. What a beautiful touch of the Holy Ghost here right now. Somebody could lift their hands and begin to speak with other tongues right now. Because the glory of the Lord is in this house. If you've got your Bible, Leviticus 16, this is the instructions to the sons of Aaron on the day that we know to be the Day of Atonement. And this whole chapter is given. and it would take a while. We probably need to do it at some point, take a while to walk through all these verses and make them make us to see where how Jesus fulfilled them. I'll take just a few of them tonight. I think my mission is to build the faith of the people of God in the sacrifice Jesus made for us. And it wasn't just something that was flung into the scheme of things, but it had been planned from the foundation of the world, but appeared in the middle of history. It's the day dawned, the day star rose. My God, aren't you thankful for the revelation that you have of water baptism in Jesus' name and the infilling of the Holy Ghost? Don't you ever let it get old, church. Just bask in the light. Hallelujah. Jesus revealed to me that I've got to be baptized. I need to be baptized in Jesus' name. Now, let's go to, I want to do this for just a moment. And I think I failed to write down, because it's coming, it's Simon Peter's writings. Projection may be able to find it, where he said, sprinkle your conscience. And I'm thinking it's 2 Peter, but maybe somebody can find me that. Leviticus 16 and 18, he shall go out unto the altar that is before the Lord, make an atonement for it, and shall take of the blood of the bullock and of the blood of the goat, put it on the horns of the altar. This is the altar of incense round about. Now, verse 19, he shall sprinkle of the blood upon it with his finger seven times and cleanse it and hallow it from the uncleanness of the children of Israel. On the Day of Atonement, blood had to be sprinkled. It wasn't splashed on the door. It wasn't typified in the people coming immersed in the Red Sea, but this time it was sprinkling. Simon Peter picks this up, I think it's Simon Peter, later on in the New Testament, and he talks about having your conscience sprinkled. Is it Hebrews 10:22? I know Simon Peter talks about this too, but Hebrews 10:22, somebody says, having your conscience sprinkled and our bodies washed with pure water. There is a composition. It's an amalgamation. It's a compressing together. And when you get the water, you get the blood. And when you go down in the water, there's an application of the blood in initial salvation method. But then when you start walking with God and you do something, and I didn't even know that's what you wanted, Lord. I didn't, and so I repent. Then what happens is the blood of Jesus, now you're not going back and getting baptized again. The blood of Jesus through faith sprinkles the conscience. And it's just as if you got buried again. Church, let the blood of Jesus go on atoning for you. See, we have a mediator right now. There is one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. That's not only initial, but right now, if I mess up, he is faithful and he is just. Where is that? Where is that? 1 John 2 and 1. 1 and 2, we'll get to that in a minute. Let's go to 1 John 2 and 1. Maybe. My little children, these things I write unto you, that they sin not. And if any man sin, we have a counselor. We have a paraclete. We have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. If we confess our sins, is that verse 2? He is faithful. He's the propitiation for our sins. Not only ours, sins of the whole world. Verse 3. I'm out of steam. Where's that verse that says, and if we confess our sins, maybe it's the last verse. What verse is that? Y'all over here quoting it, but I got to prove it. Help me out. Come on, preacher. Huh? 1 John 1 and 9. This is studying on the fly, isn't it? Let's read it together. 1, 2, 3. Verse 10. No, I don't like that. I'm looking for that. And the blood of Jesus Christ cleanseth us. The blood of Jesus, if we'll confess it, the blood of Jesus Christ. 1:7. For if we walk in the light, the revelation, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanseth us from all sin. Church, it's a package deal. When you got the Passover blood, you got the potential of blood to put you in the covenant, and then you got blood to keep you in the covenant. Jesus Christ didn't just shed blood to get us out of Egypt. He shed blood to get us in the promise and to keep us there. Hallelujah. Somebody in this room needs to know, I've got the blood of Jesus. All I got to do is repent. And the blood of Jesus is at work. All right, now I've got to throw a little curve here. This is going to seem like it doesn't even matter, but if you'll just think on it the rest of the week, then it may matter to you. In Exodus 28, go to Exodus 28, 31 and 32, there was a law given concerning the high priest's garments. The high priest's garments. And thou shalt make the robe of the ephod all of blue, and there shall be a hole in the top of it. So it's a seamless garment, and it's got a hole in the top of it. It's called a habergeon. There it is. And it settles upon the shoulders, and it's a seamless ephod. And it shall have a binding of woven work round about the whole of it, as if it were the whole of a habergeon, that it be not rent. He's using New King James, and that's fine because that's exactly what it means. Don't tear it. Don't rip it. Okay? This was a commandment throughout the ages. Many believe that the original one that Moses had made was the one that was even used in the second temple. That just as their shoes, when they came out of Egypt, didn't wear, then these holy garments never aged. Who knows? I tend to believe it. God can do it. Anything in the presence of God is timeless. My God. And so this garment, throughout the time, and now we're at the second temple. It's called Herod's temple. Everybody with me? I know I'm giving you some details here, but it's important. And so here is the officiating that's going on in the second temple, Herod's temple. And now Jesus shows up in Mark chapter 14. I'm in verse 61. Watch what happens. Here, if you look around there preceding, you're going to see something very unique. Caiaphas was the high priest of the time. Jesus, who is the true high priest, comes and has a meeting with Caiaphas, the administrator of the old covenant. And so the top dog of the priestly system of the old covenant and the lion of the tribe of Judah are meeting. And Caiaphas questions him, but Jesus kept silent and answered nothing. And so again, Caiaphas, the high priest, asked him, saying, "Are you the Christ?" The Son of the Blessed. Jesus said, "I am. And you shall see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power and coming in the clouds of heaven." And watch what happened in the next verse. the high priest. It's Passover, church. He's got his garments on. And the high priest tore his clothes. And every theologian that has any salt that I know is affirmative that at that moment the priesthood departed from Jerusalem. That when they ripped that garment, when that Caiaphas ripped that high priest, when that high priest ripped the garment, the priesthood was over. And it was transferred. The priesthood got transferred to the one who was going to be our high priest. My God. He's not only our high priest, he's our lamb. My God in heaven. Woo! He's also the altar upon which it's offered. He's everything. Jesus is our everything. He's the lamb. He's the lion. He's the, my God in heaven. Somebody ought to let the day, just let something happen in a space and an experience of revelation right now. It's all about Jesus. Everything from the center to the circumference, it's all about Jesus. Somebody shout. Somebody rejoice. About Jesus right now. Right now in the moment of revelation, you can lift your hands and be born of the Spirit because you see Him. He's your everything. And when He ripped those clothes, the priesthood left Aaron and went to the real Aaron. It left Aaron and Levi, and it went to Jesus and the bride. This is why Peter could pick up the pen and say, "Ye are a chosen generation. You, my God, are a royal priesthood. You're a holy nation. You're a peculiar people." Church, there's an outpouring here right now. If you've been waffling, if you've been kind of wavering under, is the blood really? Yes. He fulfilled every dot and crossed every T. Jesus fulfilled it all. If you look closely, He's everything. He's in that book from Genesis to Revelation. Jesus, the one you're worshiping right now. He's the Son of the living God, but He's the God of the everlasting Father. I gotta worship Him. Come on, you don't need a beat of a drum. You can worship God for the blood, the power of the blood. At that moment when the priesthood collided, the old order was abolished. And the new covenant. Was about to become enforced. Because the death of the testator had to happen. Praise God. Let me give you one more evidence. I'm getting happy up here. My God, I'm getting happy. I'm only saying half of what's going through my head. Jesus is, He's my everything. Come on, somebody. There's a flow of the Holy Ghost here right now. You square your shoulders. You stand ramrod straight for Jesus. You're not serving a fabled fiction, a historical event. You are serving the one that was said, "I am the lion and the tribe of Judah. I'm the offspring. I'm the root and the offspring of David." Oh, I feel something happening in the atmosphere of this city right now. I believe this is a day that's about to happen. Day of the Lord is coming. The revelation of Jesus is about to happen. Not only in the clouds, but in our city. There's going to be people that earth begin to receive the Holy Ghost. It's the day of the Lord. Can you hear me? I said it's the day of the Lord. So cometh as a thief in the night. Praise God. Let's just close our eyes and love Him right now. You don't have to lift up your voice, but just if you just love the Lord right now. Thank you for being my everything, Lord. Thank you for being my all in all. Let me give you just another couple of things here. Oh, the blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus. That washes white. Leviticus 16:23. We're just going to pick this one out. The whole book is full, but this one is so powerful. When the high priest shall come into the tabernacle of the congregation, he's already been behind the veil, and now he's coming out. The Bible says that he shall put off the linen garments which he put on when he went into the holy place and shall leave them there. This became evidence that the high priest had sprinkled the mercy seat on the Day of Atonement, and the people were now reconciled to God. Once the priesthood of Aaron transferred to our high priest, the Lord Jesus Christ, it was necessary that Jesus also fulfill this law of atonement in that he is going to leave the linen as evidence that the mercy seat in the heavens has been sprinkled once and for all. John chapter 20 and verse 3, Peter therefore went forth, and the other disciple, everybody say John, Peter and John. And John came to the sepulcher, so they ran both together, and the other disciple, John, did outrun Simon Peter and came first to the sepulcher. Verse 5 says, and he stooping down, looking in. What did he see? He saw the linen clothes lying there. John was most suited to give us this detail because he was a friend of the high priest. He knew the high priestly system and the order of Aaron. And so he's writing now as an aged elder, somewhere around 90 years old or more. And he tells his agnostic audience, in the Gospel of John, I saw the linen there. I was the first one to the tomb. And when I looked in, the first thing I saw was evidence that my high priest had sprinkled the mercy seat. I feel like I'm hitting a wall right now. Preacher, I don't even understand what you're saying. Just keep on listening. Because it's not up to me to turn that light on. It's up to him to turn that light on. And when he turns that light on and you see, oh, wow, he fulfilled it all. He didn't leave one thing unfulfilled. I've been from Genesis to Revelation in this book, and Jesus did it all. Man, I'm getting excited all over again. It makes me want to get back in the book tomorrow morning early and say, what else you got for me, Jesus? I want to see you again today from another angle. Jesus Christ is our everything. And now we have the second witness, verse 6. Then cometh Simon Peter following him and went into the sepulchre. See, John was, so he knew something holy was happening, so he didn't go in. If you look in the verse before, it says he looked in, but he didn't go in. Yet he did not go in. John is, he's cautious about holy things. Simon Peter, man, he's just like a bull in a china shop. Simon Peter came, went right into the tomb. And what's the first thing Simon Peter says? He saw the linen clothes lying there. To these Jewish boys, they knew Passover had done dovetailed into atonement. He done been behind the veil. He's done been in the holy place. And while he's dying on the cross, what happened to that veil over there in the temple? It started at the top. And God says, I'll not only just let the priesthood be transferred in a figure of the ephod, but I'm fixing to rip the veil off of this thing. And from the top to the bottom, the old was abolished, and out stepped the presence of God into the brand new covenant. Church, you are in the new covenant. Come on in. Come on in. You've got blood waiting on you. If you sin, confess it, and the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us. See, all this must be said against the backdrop of the beginning. I'm concluding that this is a day of atonement. We are living in the day of atonement right now. This is the day when reconciliation is happening. Romans chapter 5, verse 8. Whatever version you've got. But God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more then. Passover, he died because we were yet sinners. Much more then, having now. Who's he writing to? Talk to me. He's writing to the church in Rome. He's writing to the ones that have already been through the water, come through Passover. They're in the new covenant now. He said, but much more now, having been justified by his blood, we shall be saved. We've been saved from the past. We've been saved from the sins of the past. But this blood that I'm talking about called atonement, it's about blood that'll carry you all the way to the end. I'm determined to hold out. I'm determined that the blood of Jesus has power to keep me to go on. Shall be saved from the wrath through him. For if we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son. Say those two words out loud with me, would you? Much more. Being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. Let's stand and read verse 11 together, all of us. Ready? And not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have what? Now received our atonement. Well, I've got a message for all of those that are still following Judaism. The real Lamb has come. I don't mean to upset anybody or make them mad, but I have to tell you, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world is come. And we have hope that the blood of bulls and of goats and the ashes of a heifer sprinkling could never do for the conscience what one time of the sprinkling of the blood of Jesus does. Let's lift our hands and thank Him for the blood. Oh, the blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus. It washes white as snow. Oh, the blood. If you've got just a minute, some have to go, but if you've got just a minute to step out in the aisles with lifted hearts, if you got any energy left for the day, let's give our last energy to Him today. And just thank Him for the blood of Jesus. It washes white. I'm so thankful for the blood. And I'm so thankful for the blood. But you may want to take a brother or a sister by the arm and just say thank God for the blood. We have fellowship together tonight because of the blood. Thankful for the blood. Thankful for the blood of Jesus. It washes white as snow. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. Help me sing it now. Oh, there is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood. Oh, sing it now. There is power, power, there's wonder-working. You can have a miracle through the blood right now of the Lamb, of the Lamb. There is power, power. The precious blood of the Lamb. There is power. Hallelujah. Let's worship the Lord together. Elder Morgan's coming. Oh, I bless your name, Lord. I bless your name. Precious blood of the Lamb. Well, there's power, power, wonder-working power. Oh, yes, of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Hallelujah. Aren't you thankful for the blood tonight? Hallelujah. The writer, I believe it was Peter, said, you know, you're not redeemed with corruptible things. Hey, what we have, he said, like silver and gold, what we have, you can't buy it with money. Amen. But it was purchased with the precious blood of Christ. Amen. What a beautiful lesson tonight. Amen. I heard a lot of things I'd never heard before, and I've been around a while. Amen. But I hope I can remember just a little bit of it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Well, rich, rich, rich teaching tonight. Our missionary prayer focus tonight is Jared and Gina Driggers, missionaries to Europe and Spain. We want to especially remember them tonight. Just ask God to use them in their missionary endeavors in the land of their calling. Amen. Let's pray for them right now in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for this missionary family, Lord. That's God assumed the burden
for these places in our world where there's lost souls. Maybe they don't know about the blood that washes away sin. God, help them to minister your word. Help them to reach the lost. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name, supply their every need. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus' name. And we have some local needs. Maybe they can flash them up. They're on my phone, but it went away. Sister Sis, Sister Brawley, Brother Delbert Hupp, Roy Bland, Debbie Jackson. Some of these I know, some of them I don't. Kelsey Dunlap, Charlie Norman, Cassandra Johnson. Amen. We're praying for Sister Lorinda every day, Sister Connie. Amen. Some others. Hallelujah. Brother Bates, I'm thinking of. Amen. Brother Paul Huffman. Amen. Anybody know anybody that needs prayer? Anybody been praying? Amen. Even before you got to church for all these folks, let's do it again. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We're glad and thankful we can call on your name. Hallelujah. We can trust you with every situation and every circumstance. Lord, we know that we're saved by the blood and we're healed by the stripes. Hallelujah. That was placed on your back. Touch each and every one tonight, we pray. Jesus' name. Do the work, oh God. Only you're able to do. And we praise you for it. Go with us from this service. Keep us close to you. In Jesus' name. Everybody say amen. Hallelujah. God bless you tonight.